Good morning. Let's stand together. Let's begin our time to worship by proclaiming joy for the fact that the Lord has come.
Quiet pause. So I was coming up to remind you that this is the time that we take up our Lottie Moon Christmas offering for international missions. Just want to encourage you to continue to give sacrificially to that offering, and we'll have the chance to catch that video at another time. But just to know that as we gather here, that are across the world, there are people who have still never heard the name of Jesus. And as we sing songs like we've sang and continue to sing Christmas songs and hear those and just kind of get in the spirit of the season, we would say that there are some that are wondering, why do you do that? Who is this Jesus that you celebrate? And so let us continue to give and pray and look for opportunities even to go. But especially in this time of the year, as we focus on Lottie Moon Christmas offering, named after a lady that was riding home as a missionary to China, pleading for people to, one, give, and two, to answer the call to go. And so that her pleas continue in her memory even today. We're at the point I saw this week that we're going to be able to increase our mission force due to sacrificial giving in previous years. But it was just a few years ago we were having to cut that number drastically. So I want to ask you to continue to give sacrificially to that offering. Thankful that you've joined us today, an opportunity that we have to gather here to worship, and I pray that truly that's what happens here, is that we worship the Lord. Let's pray together as we continue, and let's prepare our hearts for what God wants to do today. Holy Father, thank you for the privilege that's ours to be here, and the desire we have to be here because of who you are to us as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, as the one who created us, the one who saved us, and the one who sustains us. But also we're here out of the desire to worship you because we understand that you and you alone are worthy of our worship. So we think about your grace upon our life. We are humbled. We're left in awe that you would love somebody like us. We're thankful that was possible because of Jesus' willingness to come, be born of a virgin, live a sinless life, and to face the cross to die for my sins and for the sins of the world. Lord, as we gather in this place, then let true worship erupt. Let that spring from our hearts to lead to songs that we'll proclaim, to lead to a heart in which is one in which you can work, to responsiveness and receptiveness to your word. Let this time be used for your glory, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
That one too. I was just going to put in a plug. Of course, next Sunday is the Sunday before Christmas. It'll be a great time of worship again. And then on Monday evening, our candlelight service, 5 o'clock, is always a very meaningful time. Just a very simple time of worship as we sing carols and as we read scripture together. And so I'm hoping you're making plans to come to that. And once again, the call of Christmas from the angels is to come and worship. And that's what we're doing today. And let's continue to worship as Audrey leads us.
Love incarnate, love divine. Star and angels gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the Savior of humanity. Unto us a child is born, he shall reign forevermore. Noel, Noel, come and see what God has done. Son of God and Son of Man, there before the world began, born to suffer, born to save, born to raise us from the grave, Christ the everlasting Lord, he shall reign forevermore. No. Thank you.
Thank you, Audrey. Beautiful, beautiful. In the midst of life, Jesus came. And for lots of us, I know all of us at one time or another have experienced a Christmas, all the busyness, and right in the middle of life just happens, doesn't it? But we go on. It was just like that in the days of Bethlehem. People were just going about doing life. Lives had been interrupted because they had to go to Bethlehem or they go to their hometowns to register to be taxed because some dictator. And yet through that is when God chose to come through the chaos to send his son with the message that God has come to dwell among us to save us from our sins. What can we do but rejoice? We're going to sing Good Christian Men Rejoice. Christy, do we have words now? Great. All right. Let's stand together. We love technology, but sometimes it just is better than us, isn't it? Let's rejoice together. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Christ is born today. Man and beast before him bow, and he is in a manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of endless bliss. Jesus Christ was born. Birth the angels sing. Come adore.
If we're to believe the original miracle of Christmas, the whole world got a gift that was audacious and enormous and undeserved. And if those kinds of shenanigans are on the table, maybe I can also ask for ridiculous, audacious things. Like joy for my family. For my friends. For my neighbors. Maybe I'm allowed to ask for peace. For the person who doesn't fit in. Or sings out of tune. Had the hardest year of his life. And I want more hope. I want to be the hands and feet of hope to others. No matter what they believe, no matter what they've done, no matter where they're from. Christmas gifts this year.
If you had the audaciousness to ask God for anything this Christmas, what would you ask Him? Would it be something for someone else? Would it be something for yourself? Be something made for a combination of you and someone else. In all probability then, as you're asking, God is going to tell you that's going to take a change of plans in your life. Maybe it's something which you have been praying about, begging God for, whatever the case may be, and that God says, you know what, I want to give you that, but we got to make some adjustments in your life. If you'll join me this morning in Matthew chapter 1, a familiar passage, which is the tendency of the Christmas story is to kind of breeze past that. I want us to camp out today on Joseph's account, or Matthew's account of Joseph. But Joseph finds out how God is changing the plans that Joseph had for his life and how the audaciousness of God to do that and for Joseph to come around to the surrender that we see here. Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. Matthew writes, this is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate the marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Every family has at least one, and that's a crazy aunt or a crazy uncle. Now, if you say your family doesn't have one, then, well, you're it, and they just hadn't told you yet, okay? But my family has a plethora of aunts, but it's particularly one that takes the cake. She's more of always been more of a grandmother than an aunt to us. Essentially, she raised my mom, but she has spent most, I guess, all of my life in Tennessee, where she raised her kids and was a school teacher up there. But so she would always, and still now, would make plans to come back home, whether it be for holidays or just for a visit, whatever. And I can't tell you how many times she'd make plans. So, you know, she calls and she's coming, and those people have to give like a major warning that they're coming, right? And everything has to be clean. So you start cleaning the house because company's coming, and then you have to eat like you never eat any other time. And so you go to the store, you buy all this food. But my crazy aunt was well known, and still is, for about a day or two before calling and announcing a change of plans. She couldn't come. She always had an excuse, and they've grown larger through the years and less believable through the years. And now my mom will tell you she doesn't go and buy the groceries that she used to until like she's there. Then they go to the store together. Because all the years of the plans having to be changed. Now, I can remember the frustration that would be there. There was anticipation that she was coming because she was always fun to be around. And to know that she was coming and going to spend some time with you, and then you had to work so hard to get everything in tip-top shape. You knew all these plans had been made, and then the frustration that came when the plans were changed. When you knew there would not be a fulfillment of them at all. You know, none of us are good with the change of plans. If we have taken time to come up with a plan, we want to see that plan carried out. But when it's changed, it builds stress. It increases anxiety in our life. We want things to go according to plan. And a lot of the reason is because we're not in control when the plan changes. And what the control we thought we had, we're reminded that we have none. We have very little, or if none at all. And so all this stress, this anxiety increases in our life. And then there's the time that it's not just plans that someone else changes, but God gets involved. And God begins to change the plans that we had for our life, that we felt were great, that we thought this is what needed to happen. Well, Joseph had plans. He was possibly, as we look here, as we meet Joseph, was possibly a teenager. For the legal age of marriage in Israel at this time was 12 for women and 13 for men. Lord forbid, right? I got a 12-year-old. Can you imagine Joseph, 13? Some believe maybe he was older, but it's kind of hard to understand that here you got two teenagers in this Christmas story. His whole life was in front of him, we would say. And I'm sure that after the process of Mary and Joseph had been chosen, you know, the family arrangement, everything was set up, that Joseph had plans that at the time he would marry Mary, and in time they would have a family, and he was going to have his carpentry business, and he was going to raise his family. He was going to be a great husband to Mary. Probably had plans for what their home was going to look like and how they were going to operate. He had this dream, this what he envisioned. And then the plans changed when Mary told him that she was pregnant. And Joseph knew it wasn't his child. He had not had relations with her. And he felt, I'm sure, betrayed, heartbroken, frustrated. And he began to lay a plan in place, Matthew tells us, to divorce Mary. And then the angel appeared to him. And his plans changed once again. At this time, God told him, "Now you take her as your wife. Don't be afraid to take her as your wife. And raise her baby as your own. And by the way, you're going to give him the name Jesus." And Joseph adjusted his plans to the plan of God. And as we look at the life of Joseph, he demonstrates what it looks like to surrender completely to God's plan, to God's will. Regardless of what others may think, regardless of what it may cost you, to fully and completely surrender to what God wants to do. We talk about that a lot, but it's probably not demonstrated in our life to the degree that we see here with Joseph. A willingness to adjust his plans to match the plans of God. And he also shows us how to respond when God changes our plans. I want us to look at those traits today. These traits that we see in Joseph's life, his response to God's change of plans. And let's see if we would find them in our life today. The first thing I see is that Joseph responded with mercy. We're told that Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. Now, this was a little different than our culture today. This was about a year-long engagement process. But it was more than an engagement in our culture. It wasn't that Joseph got on one knee and popped the question and showed a ring and Mary cried and they hugged and then they kind of went back and started planning a wedding. No, this was a contract that was made. It was an arrangement that had been set up, and it was, again, about a year-long process, and the only way to break off this engagement was through divorce. And the man, as you'll see here, is known as the husband. We're talking verse 19, Joseph, because Joseph, her husband. So in the eyes of everyone, you're already a couple, but you just haven't officially been married. And sexual relations were not supposed to happen until after the public ceremony. When Joseph gets word that Mary was pregnant, he struggled, as would most men. If your spouse came in or your fiance came in and told you that she was pregnant and the child you knew was not your own, you would struggle with that. There would be issues in the relationship. You knew the child wasn't yours. She's been unfaithful would be your first thoughts. Now imagine that all these things went through Joseph's mind. And you'll notice they're told that Joseph was faithful to the law, which the law set sexual relations before marriage as the penalty of being stoned to death. And so Joseph knew that's what the law required. And probably in his mind is, Mary, that's what she deserves. But he couldn't bear her having to, him having to see that, be a part of it, and know that she would have to go through that and lose her life that way. And by the times of the New Testament, the most common way to deal with this problem, which by the way was very uncommon, was to issue a certificate of divorce. This would involve a public trial. And so still, there's humiliation that's going to take place to Mary. And Joseph didn't want to disgrace her. So Matthew tells us that he decided to divorce her quietly, because there was an alternate means to the public trial, and that was there could be a private divorce if you had two witnesses. So Joseph was determined to divorce Mary in a way that would avoid her the most embarrassment and provide her the opportunity to move on with her life. We see that he was merciful in his dealings with her because he did not want her to receive what she deserved. That's mercy, by the way. We talk about mercy and grace. We often use those words interchangeably. But mercy is when you do not receive what you deserve. Grace is when you receive what you don't deserve. She deserved to be stoned. That was the law. And Joseph, as a man who was faithful to the law, knew that. But yet he works and he responds with mercy. And his relationship with Mary did not want her to be stoned, to be faced with that death. Did not want to humiliate her with a public trial. Wanted to deal with this quietly and go about his life and let Mary go about her life. Now think about how else he could have responded. I mean, the opposite of this mercy that he demonstrated would have been to respond very quickly and impulsively, to look at her when she broke the news to him and say, you're going to die. That's what you deserve. I'm a man that's faithful to the law. I am known in the community as one who's faithful to the law, even as a young guy, and I am not going to divulge or to divert away from that. You deserve to die. That's what's going to happen to you. Come on, let's go find the appropriate people. Or maybe if he did not want that, he could have said, hey, I'm going to get the trial together. I'll have everything in place by tomorrow. And tomorrow, everybody in this town will know what you've done. And I am done with you, Mary. But he didn't do that. He gave her what she did not deserve. He could have responded with anger. Think about how we would have responded. Probably the way in which I just gave some illustrations. Oh, no, wouldn't, well, just think about it. How do you respond when your kids mess up your plans? How do you respond when somebody at work messes up your plans? How do you respond when you get behind the slow car that's messing up your plans to be at a place at a certain time? How do you respond? Do we respond with mercy? Or do we respond quickly and impulsively with anger? Joseph shows us that when your plans are changed, that you can respond with mercy. You know, when you intentionally drive the speed limit, intentionally drive above the speed limit, and you get caught, you desire mercy, don't you? You beg for mercy, you cry for mercy, whatever else you do to try to get that officer to give you mercy. You deserve the ticket, but you don't want that. You want something else. You want the warning. So you desire mercy in that moment. But I have found that we want mercy more than we want to give mercy. Because we can be driving along a little above the speed limit, looking around everywhere for someone that might cause us to pay a penalty. And when this car comes flying past us, we immediately think, look at that idiot. They deserve to have a ticket. And when we catch up with them later and the cops behind them, we go, I hope they get a ticket. They deserve it to drive as fast as they were driving. We want mercy, but we don't want to receive mercy. We see the murderer and we say that man deserves to die. We see the drug dealer that's disrupted many families and we would say they deserve to spend time in prison. We see someone who hurts us and we say they deserve to be hurt themselves. But yet we want mercy. We don't want to give mercy. Joseph shows us that it's not just enough to be a man who can check off following the law, that can check off the whole outward appearance stuff, but it's a man who can be restrained enough to be okay to give somebody what they do not deserve. He deals with Mary with mercy. Again, we want mercy more than we want to give it, and we're thankful for mercy. For let us not forget that the wages of sin is death. You and I deserve to die. Eternal death, separated from God for all of eternity. That's what we deserve. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. That's mercy. And when we've experienced that mercy, we should desire to show that mercy. Matter of fact, Micah 6:8 tells us, what does the Lord require of you? To act justly is one of those requirements. Act justly. To love mercy, act justly, walk humbly with your God. That's what God expects from us. And there in the middle of that is to be a person who can respond to changes in plans, can respond to difficulties with mercy. Joseph demonstrates that for us. The second thing I see about when God changes our plans is that we're to respond immediately. That's how Joseph responded. After this whole encounter, he has an angel again appears to him. And verse 24 tells us, when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. When Joseph woke up, he immediately aligned himself with God's plan. He didn't question God. He didn't ask to have another night's sleep, to sleep on the decision that he had to make and give it some more thought. He didn't run to somebody and ask them their opinion or some expert advice. He didn't list the pros and the cons to try to determine what he was supposed to do. He immediately did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him to do. And he models for us the kind of obedience that God expects from each one of us, and that is an immediate obedience. One of the things that we must learn is that delayed obedience is disobedience. That when we plan to get around to it, we are being disobedient in our delay. When God, through the Spirit, speaks to us, or he directs us, we are to be immediate in our response. The same thing when we're reading his word, and in those times when God's word seems to jump off the page, and he speaks to us, he directs us something in our life, we're to be immediate in our response. The same thing when you hear a sermon, when you hear a Bible, you sit in, you hear it in Sunday school, you hear your teacher give the Bible lesson, or you're in a Bible study. When God speaks to you through the Spirit, through another person that he may use, God expects for us to be immediate in our response. not to have to count the costs, not to have to ponder what details had to be taken care of, but to be immediate in our response to Him. The same thing when you're presented with an opportunity to serve. God has equipped you. God has given you that opportunity. You should be immediate in your response to that opportunity. But here's what we often do. We can make it sound spiritual. Let me pray about that. I need to spend some time praying about it. You know what? There's certain things that you don't have to pray about. Not to diminish prayer, but when God tells you to do something, you don't have to pray about that. He's not going to tell you anything else but that. He's not going to change His mind. But we can sound real spiritual. I need some time to pray. God spoke. He's clear. And you know when those times happen in your life, when God speaks and He shows you something you need to do, something you need to rid your life of, an opportunity that you have to serve, there is no reason for you to delay your obedience because you are being disobedient in the delay. We need to be immediate in our response to Him. Several years ago, I was leading a men's Bible study, and we've been promoting that. It's going to happen Sunday night after church, and there was a teenage boy in the church who later asked his dad, who was one of my friends, "Dad, are you going to go to that men's study?" And the dad said, "I don't know, son. I'm praying about it." And it was a flip in roles as the teenager looked at dad and became the spiritual leader and said, "Dad, do you really think God's going to tell you not to go?" How often does somebody need to answer us that way? I need to pray about it. Do you really think God's going to tell you to do something that's contradicts His word? Do you really think God's going to tell you to do something that's going to hinder your growth? Do you really think that God's going to tell you to take your time and just obey when you feel like it, when it's convenient for you? No. He expects us to respond to Him immediately. Abraham models that for us all the way back in Genesis. That when the Lord tells him to leave the land in which he was familiar with, his homeland, and go to the land that He will show him, Abraham set out quickly. But we see that most of all when God tells him to sacrifice his son Isaac. We know that Abraham was 100 years old, young age of 100. When Isaac was born, he had waited and prayed for this child for years, and now Isaac is a teenager, and God tells him to sacrifice your son, your only son, whom you love. And the text tells us that early the next morning, Abraham got up and he started the process of gathering the wood and getting his son and heading to the place where God told him to go sacrifice Isaac. That immediate obedience, early the next morning he got up. Just as Joseph, after the encounter, took Mary as his wife. Why didn't they think about it a while? Why didn't they spend some time making some plans? See, a huge problem is we seek out sympathizers. We go ask people that will agree with us. I mean, can you imagine had Abraham gone to Sarah and said, "Hey, dear, I'm going to be gone for a few days and Isaac's not coming back." Huh? What are you going to do with him? Well, I'm going to kill him. Huh? Why would you come up with something outrageous? God told me to. Abraham, have you lost your mind? Number one, you're not leaving here with my baby. And number two, you're not going to lay a hand on him. You hear me? And before long, Sarah would have controlled Abraham. And I believe he had never offered a sacrifice had he told anybody and gave some time to sit around and think about it. Had Joseph gone maybe even to his dad and said, "Dad, I need to let you in on something. Mary's pregnant." No, Dad, listen, don't get upset. It's not mine." "Well, you know that requires her to be stoned." "No, Dad, listen. Last night an angel spoke to me." "Do what?" And before long, his dad, who he would have respected, would have been someone that probably could have talked him out of doing what the angel told him to do. So often we, rather than being immediate in our obedience, we try to share it with people who would sympathize with us and give us more excuses to be disobedient to what God wants us to do. If Joseph even would have sat around and thought about it, rather than being immediate, he would have been less likely to obey. And the same is true for us. The more we sit around and think about it, the more we talk to other people about it, the more we sit around and look at the pros and the cons, all those sorts of things, it's less likely that we're ever going to be obedient to the Lord. He expects us to respond immediately to Him. And the angel gives us some insight into what was going on in Joseph's mind. For she tells him in verse 20, "Do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife." That Joseph's main concern was fear. And with those words, "Do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife," the angel is telling him not to worry about what people are going to say, not to worry about what they may do to him if he married someone with a child who was not his. Instead, the angel's telling him to worry about being obedient and leave everything else up to God, not to be afraid of anyone or any other thing. How often would we look at our life and we would say it's our fears that keep us from this immediate obedience to the Lord? James teaches that when we know the good we're supposed to do and we do not do it, that we sin. So I would ask you to look at your life today. When have you not responded with obedience immediately? You may not have done the opposite, but we have to understand the areas in our life where we have not responded with obedience to God, that we are living in sin. We don't want to hear that. We don't want to point it out, and we may not want to accept that truth. But the truth is that those areas where God has told us to do something or to stop doing something or to begin an area of ministry, whatever the case is, where God speaks to us, God leads us, and we do not respond immediately, and we allow the time to pass, that we are living in sin. And it's during those times we'll often find ourselves frustrated with God. Frustrated that He changes, is changing our plan. We can even become angry with what God is doing in our life. And all we know is that God wants to carry out this plan that is good, it's pleasing, it's perfect, Scripture says, is His will for us. When God speaks, we need to respond immediately to Him. There's a third trait that I want us to see, and that's that of self-control. It goes very closely back to the mercy in which Joseph responded with. Joseph didn't just fire off the handle here. He dealt with mercy, dealt mercifully with Mary, but it's more than that. Look at verse 25. "But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus." We must understand that it is possible to do what God wants you to do and do it the wrong way. We can cut corners. We can do it however it seems best to us. We can even do it with the wrong heart or the wrong attitude. And so we would say, "Well, I did what I was supposed to do," but God would look and go, "But you weren't obedient in that." What jumps out to me, I've read this passage my whole life, had never seen verse 25 the way I have in the last couple weeks. But even after Joseph took Mary into his home, he did not have relations with her until after the child was born. Now, we have young in here today, so I won't be as blunt as maybe I could have been. But I've never met anybody in my life that lived a life of purity before marriage that remained celibate after marriage, until we find Joseph in Matthew 1:25, that would take his wife home and not have relations with her. The angel didn't tell him not to. The angel didn't tell him any details at all other than not to be afraid to take Mary home as his wife. But Joseph still refrained from relations with Mary. Why? We're not certain. But in doing so, there was no question that this child was a gift of God. There was no way anybody could ever have said, "Well, it really was Joseph's child." And we talk about Mary being a virgin at the beginning of the story. But have we ever stopped to ponder that she gave birth to the Messiah and she was still a virgin because her husband When his plans were changed, he responded to that change of plans with self-control. Self-control, by the way, is a fruit of the Spirit. That you and I, when we live a life that's under the control and the power of the Holy Spirit of God, we're going to demonstrate self-control. So those times when we fly off the handle, those times when we lose it, those times when we express anger, those times when we can't take anymore and we let people have it, all those things, and you got the picture, shows, it's evidence, it is proof that we are not living under the control of the Holy Spirit. That we are not showing the fruits of the Spirit. It involves, yes, the defeat of lust in our life, but it also affects how we respond when our plans get changed. When things don't go our way, do we demonstrate self-control? John Wooden is one of the most revered coaches in the history of college basketball. And he always credited much of his success with his dad. He wrote one time about an occasion as a boy when he watched his father in their rural Indiana county deal with a team of mules or horses that were used to pull gravel out of gravel pits. So this was common in their county. You didn't have dump trucks at the time, that they would tie up horses or mules and you would pull the wagon full of the gravel out. Some pits were deeper than others, and so sometimes it was hard for the team to pull the gravel up through the wet sand and up the steep incline. He taught him one particular day, one hot summer day, when a young farmer was trying to get his team to pull a fully loaded wagon out of the pit. And he was whipping the horses. He was cursing them. They were frothing at the mouth. They were stomping. They were backing away from him. They weren't making any progress at all. And so the elder wouldn't watch for a while. And then he went over to the young farmer and said, "Let me take them for you." John Wooden wrote that Dad started talking to the horses, almost whispering to them, and stroking their noses with a soft touch. Then he walked between them, holding their bridles and bits while he continued talking very calmly and gently as they settled down. Then he said he gradually stepped out in front of them and gave a little whistle to start them moving as he guided the reins. And within moments, those two big plow horses pulled the wagon out of the gravel pit as easy as could be. He said it was almost as if they were happy to do it. And then he wrote, "I have never forgotten what I saw him do and how he did it. Over the years, I've seen a lot of leaders act like that angry young farmer who lost control. But so much more can usually be accomplished by Dad's calm, confident, and steady approach." And he finished the article with writing, "It takes strength inside to be gentle on the outside." Take strength on the inside. That strength coming from the Holy Spirit, giving us the power that we need, living through Him, to be gentle on the outside, to be able to respond to with mercy when things don't go the way we had planned. Some of you saw the quote that I shared on social media this week, that I found it while I was studying, where one pastor wrote, "In all my years of pastoring, I've learned a lesson. A person's spiritual maturity is not truly visible until they don't get their way. Then you see the person." And you've all got examples of that. We've got the scars to prove it. Someone we thought was mature until they didn't get their way. And then they showed a lack of self-control, a lack of mercy. They may have responded immediately, but they responded in a way that wasn't honoring to God. Joseph, though, shows us how to live a life of obedience, of complete surrender again to the plan of God, that when God changes our plans, we don't get all up in arms, but we respond with immediacy. And when someone else is involved in that, maybe they do something that changes our plans, that we don't respond with hate or anger, but we respond with mercy and self-control. And that was just the first part of Joseph's obedience that we see. Later, he would move his family to Egypt at the command of God, because God had warned him not to stay there. He would later settle in Nazareth at the command of God. He raised Jesus as his own son at the command of God. He was a man of faith, for he trusted God when God disrupted his plans, and he just kept on trusting. And now you and I are called to trust in his son. The same trust that Joseph showed to God that we are to show to the Lord through his son, of placing our faith in him, beginning with a personal relationship where we surrender our life to Jesus Christ, admitting to him that we're a sinner in need of a Savior, and realizing that the Savior is Jesus who came to die on the cross for our sins. Not only did he die, but 3 days later he rose again. And believing that, we confess, we make him the Lord of our life, that he's in control, and we surrender our life to him. And that's the first step in trusting the son of Joseph. But it's a continual process of trusting. When he disrupts our life, when things don't go the way that we planned or that we wanted them to or we hoped they would, that we just walk in obedience with him as a one who's full of mercy and self-control and ready and willing to respond to the leadings of God. It was one night at a D.L. Moody evangelist meeting in Brockton, Massachusetts, that a young man stood up to give his testimony. He started off by saying, "I'm not quite sure about the work of God in my life." Meaning he couldn't put it all together about how God had saved him from his sins and what that meant to him. But he continued by saying a phrase that stuck with those in attendance. After he said, "I'm not quite sure, but I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey. I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey." Daniel Towner was the song leader for that meeting. He was so impressed by this young man's testimony that he wrote down those words and he stuck them in his pocket. "I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey." Later, he wrote a friend by the name of John Samus. And in his letter, he told about this testimony and he included those young man's word, that young man's words. "I'm not quite sure, but I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey." John Samus quickly transform those words into a hymn chorus. "Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey." And before long, he had 5 stanzas to go along with those courses, and he would later send, or that course, he later would send it to back to the original man, to Daniel Towner, and he composed the tune that we still sing some today. "There's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey." And you may find yourself today, we're understanding that young man, "I'm not quite sure." You may say, "I'm not quite sure, God, what you're doing. I'm not quite sure how it's going to turn out. Not quite sure what this is going to look like, God. I'm not quite sure, God, if I can give up control. Not quite sure, God, that I can accept what you're doing. I'm not quite sure, God," fill in the blank of what God's doing in your life. But can you finish? "But I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey." I can't think of a better life plan than that. It was the plan of Joseph. "I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey." It'd be a plan for us all to follow. So I'd ask you today, can you say, "God, I'm not quite sure what you're doing, but I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey." Would you bow with me? And maybe as you respond that way, God says, then what you need to do is, and he gives you something that you need to be obedient in your obedience of. Maybe you're here today and you don't have a relationship with Jesus, and you say, "God, I'm not quite sure what you're doing, but I realize I'm a sinner." And God says, then what you need to do is declare your need for me. "God, I'm not quite sure what you're up to." And God tells you, but right now, this is what you need to do. You need to trust. You need to obey. Maybe there's something that's keeping you awake at night that's antagonizing you, you're struggling with, because you haven't responded with mercy and with self-control. Not only does that issue keep you awake, but how you responded is what keeps you awake. The Lord would tell you today, listen, you just need to trust you need to obey. Father, today, let this place be marked by trust and obey. Trusting and obeying you. Lord, we know there's no other way to be happy in you but to trust and obey. Those aren't just words we can sing. It's a reality that we experience in our life. So maybe we come here today with an unhappiness, an uneasiness, a burden, because we haven't obeyed, we haven't trusted. Maybe we're struggling with what you're doing with our life and how you're adjusting our plans. Let us trust. Let us obey, Lord. Pray for what you want to do during this time of commitment. As there's personal decisions that need to be made, some public, some private, but let them be made, Lord. Let us be obedient to you. As you've spoken to us and as you lead us, let us respond immediately to your call. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand together? And as we sing this familiar Christmas hymn, it's our time of invitation. Its altar's open. We'll be here to receive you. Let us be marked by trust and by obedience.
How silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his hand. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin,
I just thank you for this day and thank you for letting us come together as a church family, Lord. I just pray that when you change our plans, that we just follow you, Lord. We follow your plans that you have for us. Lord, just thank you so much and we love you. Forgive us our sins and bless these tithes and offerings to your service. In your name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
As always, it's been an honor to worship with you today. I want to encourage you to know what's happening, know what's going on in your bulletin. As we sing a lot, the Holy Night that changed the world, there's a lot of things, you know, Sunday school parties and stuff going on. But Wednesday evening, and we're having our church-wide Christmas fellowship. We're not the our meal at 5:30, our service at 6 will be our fellowship time together. You're asked to bring finger foods to share that evening, and are looking forward to that time of fellowship. That's also when your angel tree gifts are due and the meal that goes home with those who are receiving the gifts. So had asked today, the meal, your ham or turkey that you bring is not to be cooked. It's something that they can do on Christmas. So if you can help us with that on the tree in the foyer of the education building and back here, there are the cards that means we need that meal, and it'll tell you the things that we need for it. If you could pick those up and bring those items with you Wednesday as well. And then next Sunday as we gather, one of those high-attended Sundays historically of the year, and families often come together for that. And so we're going to do just a quick free family photo for anyone that wants those, but that is not the photo for the directory. Your insert there, you need to go online and sign up for that. That's in January. That'll be the printed thing that you get of everybody's picture in the church that participated. But next weekend, you don't get that picture, okay? You just get yours. You don't get everybody else's, so don't get confused on that. But if you would continue to sign up, go to the church website, you'll see the link to click. Or if you can't do it, Bill Michaels is right up there, and he's got a computer that can help you afterwards. Bill, wave in case somebody doesn't know you. Okay. If you don't know Bill, you see you've been missing a whole lot. And so he can help you get signed up. You'll catch him before he leaves here today. And so he usually tries to escape quickly, but now he can't. All right, one last thing, money, if you would come here. Money, if you see him, usually, you're supposed to be on this side, money, so scoot down here. There you go. Okay, right, stop. Sit. Okay, good. All right. It takes a lot of courage, number one, to be obedient to the Lord, to say you've gotten some things out of order. And money is a member of our church and has, through some leadership at BSU on his college campus and talking to Aaron, realized that his baptism and his salvation were out of order, that he was baptized before he was truly saved. And so he has placed his faith in Jesus Christ and has never been obedient to be baptized after salvation. And he wants to share that with you all today. And we will be doing that probably the first Sunday of the year once we get the Christmas tree down and the lights out of the baptistry, that we can get back in there. That we'll be doing that. And so, you know, no action required of you, but I know you want to let him know how proud of him you are, that he would respond, number one, immediately, but respond in humility to say that's the step he wanted to take. So, Money, I'm going to let you go back there while we sing, but come back up here and let them come and express their love for you and their support of you, if they would. All right? Let's stand together, and we're going to sing I Have Seen the Light as we're dismissed. I hope you have a great rest of the week.
I have seen the light shining in the darkness. Reigns on heaven's throne.